So, you, how did you find out about the notorious RBG t-shirts?
I think a law clerk told me about this Tumblr.
I usually start out an interview with some sort of softball questions, and I'm actually not going to do that tonight. I want to focus on the here and now. So, Justice Ginsburg, you were up until 5 a.m. on Friday night, Saturday morning, writing a passionate dissent in the Texas voter ID case. Just to let people in the audience know, this was a procedural question in some measure, and you can note a dissent in those kinds of cases and not write, and it's fairly common for that to happen. But you wrote, you were joined by Justices Kagan and Sotomayor. So why did you write, and why did it take until 5 in the morning?
Why till 5 in the morning? We didn't get the last filing from Texas until Friday morning. And then the circuit justice, as you know, has to write a memo. And that came around sometime in the middle of the afternoon. So there wasn't much time to write the dissent. I had written a dissent in the North Carolina voting case, voting rights case. This one was, as you said, I would say it was very well reasoned. You called it passionate.
The point you were making, to explain a fact of law here is that in 2006, the Supreme Court issued a decision that basically said, we try not to disturb what's going on in elections right before the election because people will get confused. And you said you didn't think that applied here. Why?
First, this case was unlike the others because it had gone through a complete 9-day trial, reams of evidence, and an excellent decision written by the district court. This was a new system for Texas from 2003 to 2013. They had a voter ID that was reasonable. There were many things that you could present. The new law cut back drastically on that. There had never been a federal election held under the new law. There had been local elections with a very small turnout. So the poll watchers were more familiar with the old procedure than they were with this new procedure. So I didn't think that this case fell into the mold of we can't disturb an election. There had been very little in the way of educational efforts so that people would know what the new law required, so that the poll watchers would know. So I thought that the old system would involve less disruption than this never done in a federal election before.
We opened this term of the Supreme Court on the opening day. There were 7 same-sex marriage cases before the Supreme Court from 5 states, and the court decided not to decide any of those cases, leaving in place decisions from 3 federal appeals courts, and in total covering an additional, in addition to the states that had already been covered in those particular cases, I think 11 more states.
And one after the first, we had the first list, had, I don't remember how many, but there was one after that.
Yeah. And this was, it was really, from the point of view of somebody who covers the Supreme Court, pretty interesting because both sides, the winners and the losers, were begging the court to resolve this issue. And I have to say that I think almost everybody, with the possible exception of you, was surprised that the court just said, we're not doing this now. So what are we to make from take from that?
Anina, you know that when there's no disagreement among the courts of appeals, we don't step in. I mean, the major job that the court has is to keep the law of the United States more or less uniform. So when courts of appeals disagree about what the law of the United States is, then we are obligated to grant review. If there had been a court of appeals on the other side, we probably would have taken that case. But up to now, all of the courts of appeals agree, so there is no crying need for us to step in.
At some point, I'm assuming, perhaps I'm wrong, but I'm assuming that some court may, some federal appeals court, the three remaining that have cases are the most conservative courts in
yes.
the country, and I think it's reasonable to anticipate that at least one of them may reach a different conclusion. So, but with three quarters of the country now having gay marriage, is it really feasible to envision going back?
Going
back to not allowing it in the states where it's now allowed?
I can't give an opinion on that.
So I want to ask you, she never makes news when I interview her, never. I tried the last time I was here. She's really good at this. I want to ask you one other question about this, and then I want to move on to Chief Justice, AKA President Beinisch, because in Israel, the Chief Justice is called President. And I didn't want to confuse you. So there's been a good deal written by my kind and by academics about the fact that we're two or three weeks into the term, and we've had three or four election cases decided by without a decision for the court. The only thing we know in any of them, for example, in the Texas voter ID case, is your dissent. But there may have been other dissenters who didn't want to join your dissent for one reason or another. The same held true in the case involving the abortion restrictions enacted in Texas, which the court did stay, did block from going into effect. But we don't, again, really know much about that. There's nothing the court has said about any of these cases. And of course, they're the same-sex marriage cases. And I can't remember a time in my coverage of the court where there have been such a cluster of big, important decisions that affect how we conduct business in the country, whether it's the elections or abortions or not abortions or marriage. And we don't know anything about why.
Nina, you know that these were all emergency applications and an answer was needed swiftly. Take the Texas abortion clinics cases. If the court didn't act, then the number of clinics in that state would be reduced from 41 to 7. The court had to act one way or another to say either it was okay to reduce the number to 7 or it wasn't okay. There was tremendous time pressure, so the vote on these emergency applications, it all happens within 24 hours. And you know that when we write an opinion, we have to circulate it to all of our colleagues. Some may ask us to take out this or put in that. There was no time to go through that process.
Chief Justice Beinisch, Israel is the only country that conscripts women as well as men into the military. It was among the first democratic countries to have a woman leader, Golda Meir. And yet today there are religious forces in Israel that want women and men segregated on buses, in public places, forces that oppose women in positions of authority, in the military, don't want them training people. And now ultra-Orthodox men are no longer to be exempt from the military, but they object to serving with women and being trained by women. So is Israel going backwards on women's rights?
No, I don't think so. It's much more complicated. I mean, you know, when I think about the equality that women should have, even before, and before the ultra-Orthodox intervened, this is relatively a small minority. This is not the main problem. Those are closed societies that now are trying, we are trying to have them integrated in society. And then we have to find a way to change the situation and the rights of women inside those societies, because this is, of course, one of the problems. But I must tell you that in spite of the fact that women served in the military and were, and as you said, we had a prime minister woman, I'm not satisfied until now with the equality of women. And with this, I think we are very similar in our societies. It's in your society, in the United States, and unfortunately, I think we can say it about many liberal democratic states. I don't think we achieved for women what we should have achieved and what should be done. I mean, the buses is a very small, it's not that all over the country you don't go in buses, women and men. It's in a very small area where, of course, the court decided that they should let them, but even the women there are not interested, as you know, sometimes. It's a very special social group. I'm worried about the fact that until now, as you said, with all the achievements we had for women, the wages of women are not equal to those of men. Most of the women in working force have their salaries or their wages are 80% of those of men. I think it's more difficult to get their work in certain positions. It's much better we have now women in very important roles in economy but yet, of course, in the judiciary. But yet, this process is not finished. And this is, you know, we had a very, very similar case to your famous, how is it, Lily Ledbetter? I had exactly the same case of a woman that worked the same work that a man worked in the same home store, home office. And then she found out that her wages is 3,500 shekel, his is 5,000. And only in our judgment we decide, and we have legislation since 1964, that they have to pay the same wages. Yet it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So we decided that it is for the employer to convince and to show in evidence that it's not discrimination case of women. This was a big change. So this is a problem all over.
Let me follow up particularly about something that you said. You said that the ultra-Orthodox are a very small portion of the population of Israel. It is true that ultra-Orthodox are 10% of the country, but they're 33% of they're 30% of the first graders in the country. And 33% of the Israeli military is female. It's a very difficult dilemma.
I don't believe that women will not serve because we decided, and it's also our core decision, that ultra-Orthodox should serve in the military. Now very few of them, a very small percentage, started to serve. Maybe it will change in their units, but I don't believe it will change the character of the military service. It's impossible. This, I don't believe. But it's a process. It's a social process that takes time until it will develop the way we want it to be.
Justice Ginsburg, there are a lot of liberals in academia who have been publicly urging you to retire so that President Obama can appoint your successor. Your answer?
To people who have made that suggestion, I ask a question. And the question is, who do you think that our president could nominate and get through today's Senate that you would because in life, it's always, what is the alternative? Either I stay or someone, if anyone could get through, it would not be someone that has my record.
I don't think it's funny. It's not funny at all. You just mentioned the decision of Justice Ginsburg in the last 2 days. Who replaces Justice Ginsburg? No one.
Well, but the other
I
question.
I have to say, in fairness to the critics, that if I had been where Dorit was, I would no longer be on the court because Israel has an age 70.
Yes.
It's a compulsory retirement. There are very few, in fact, I don't think there's any country that treats its federal judges as our Constitution requires them to be treated. That is, we hold our offices during good behavior. And federal judges on the whole are well-behaved people. It means essentially that we're there for life, but the founders in their wisdom thought that that was the way to protect judicial independence, that you can't. If the president doesn't like what we're doing, or the Congress doesn't like what we're doing, well, it's just too bad.
Well, you could observe, I suppose, that I don't know of any other justice that pulled a 5 o'clock all-nighter. The follow-up, though, the serious follow-up to your answer, I think, would be that the question isn't whether Obama can get someone through the Senate who's as good as you are from his point of view and from the point of view of liberals, but whether a Republican president in 2017 might appoint someone who's quite alien to the positions that you advocate for.
Well, I'm very hopeful about 2016.
I just serve him up and she hits him out of the park. So you're 81 years old, you've had cancer twice, you look marvelous, darling. So what do you do? So what do you do to keep in shape?
I have a personal trainer who comes to the court. Nina, you've seen the small gym that we have for the principal offices and the justices. So my trainer comes twice a week, and he's what keeps me in shape. And I've been doing this since 1999, because when I got through with colorectal cancer, my dear spouse said, "Ruth, you look like a survivor of Auschwitz. You've got to do something to build up your strength." And so I started. And I am a very compulsive worker, as you know. I don't want to let go if I think I've got an idea. But when it's 7 o'clock, I train from 7 to 8, so nobody else is in the gym at that time. Whatever I'm doing, I
We're
stop.
We're talking evening here.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, I never. Justice O'Connor had an aerobics class, but it was eight in the morning. 8 in the morning, not my time of day, so.
So we have something in common. the evenings is a good time to work.
She does push-ups. I can't do any push-ups. Can you do push-ups?
No, I can't do any sport. Never had done anything which is with sports.
Well, Justice Scalia portrays Justice Ginsburg as sort of a physical daredevil, even that she goes parasailing. He said, she's just this little bit of a thing up there parasailing. I wasn't sure she was going to come back down. So I want to know, what if anything, have you given up in the name of caution?
I think I've given up water skiing. You know, I won't say that I've given up horses. I haven't ridden in quite a while, but I think if I had an opportunity, I would.
So, President Beinisch, yes. Do you have a workout routine? Do you have a workout routine at all?
No, that's not.
The Israeli court system is very different from ours. First of all, you're closely involved in national security questions.
Yes.
You can and have reviewed military operations. Explain how that works, for example, with the security fence case, the decision you wrote on the security fence.
We had more than 100 cases on security fence. But it's not to explain one case, to understand that the Israeli court has to face problems of how to strike the balance between security and human rights since its establishment. All the years, we always had security problems. And if you give up court review, you may lose your democratic character of the state. So what we did with offense cases is also to strike a balance. We accepted that military opinion that in order to stop those really terrible terror attacks that we had between the year 2002, terrible, with buses exploding and cafes exploding and everywhere people couldn't go in the streets, that the fence would stop this infiltrating of the suicide bombers that we suffered so much from. The problem, and this is a typical case of proportionality or striking the balance, because the problem was that, of course, every military commander wants to be on the safe side, to take more land in order to build this fence. And we said it's impossible. You can take only the minimum needed for security, not to take this as an excuse to take more land, to be on. It's never 100% security, so you have to find what is the price you pay when you're taking land from farmers, from Palestinian farmers, whom we are responsible for the world. So this is what a court did. And actually, what was very special about it, all those Palestinians from the territories where Israeli law doesn't apply, but it applies on their military commanders, could apply to the Supreme Court, directly to the Supreme Court. And we were sitting with the maps and the aerial photos, seeing the itinerary of the fence and see why do they need to take so much? Can they take less? And they did. The whole itinerary of the fence changed because the court was looking into this matter, you know, 1 mile after the other. We just did the work because we are first and last instance. Our system is really very different.
I would like to ask Dorit a question about that. Now, if a question like that were to come up in the United States, we would look to the Constitution. How does Israel protect the human rights side of the balance when you don't have a constitution? Where do you get the norms from?
Well, this is really, I think, very difficult to explain when you talk about the American notion that everything is based on the Constitution. First of all, since 1992, we do have basic laws, and the basic laws, they are not a full formal constitution, but part of it is in the, like a constitution. We even have a judicial review on legislation in accordance with those basic laws. So this is actually a constitution where rights are enshrined in the basic laws. But we, even before, we couldn't review the legislature, but we could review acts of the administration, of the executive, according to the norms, the principal universal norms of equality, like in every democratic state. Equality, rights of the life, right to liberty, property, all this was actually our common law. This was a creation of the court until 1992, that we have the basic law since then. And that's what we do. And as what has to do with the territories, we also apply international law according to the principle of the Fourth Geneva Convention and the Hague Convention. So the norms are there. The question is if everyone respects and applies them. And this is the role of the court, to see that it will be so. And we take, if it's the rule of proportionality, and we see it used to be reasonableness or proportionality, equality is a basic norm. Although this is not even enshrined in our basic laws, but this is part of our common law.
You hear, actually, administrative detention cases, and because your court can hear cases directly up from the bottom, people can appeal directly to you, you actually do are involved in hearing some of these cases that are sort of similar to, I guess we would say, Guantanamo cases, except that you actually review these cases and investigate them. You have the power to investigate. But how does that work? I mean, you're not investigators per se.
No, it's exaggerated to say that we really investigate. The thing is, the situation of administrative detention is nothing that any court in a democratic state likes, because it's not the adversary system, it's completely different. It's secret material, which is a problem. So how does it work? The detainees can, after they are going to the military courts, they can apply to the Supreme Court. And we are ready in judicial review to see every case. Normally, their representatives, they are represented in court, and normally their representatives agree that we'll see the material, the secret material, we'll look into it, and we'll weigh how serious it is. We get explanations from the security people. This is not the ideal system, because we don't have the two parties adversaries. Yet, we know as much as we can about the case when we read all this material, the secret material, and they rely on the court. I must say that with this, it is accepted that they can ask the court to see the material, and this is most of the cases of administrative detention. And we can see if it's too long, if it takes too much time, what is the reason? Is there enough basis for keeping them in detention?
So one of your top assistants recently wrote a law review article,
yes,
in which he said that the bottom line still was the same, because the evidence is obviously classified, the accused can't see it or rebut it, and the court is simply unable to challenge the security forces, meaning that the security forces always win.
No, that's not true. I read it. I know that she was really working with me too. I don't agree with it. I mean, as I said before, it's not the ideal. It's never the ideal in those cases to see material ex parte. But I think it's the best we can do in that situation. What she claims is that we rely on the security people and we accept whatever they say. Well, this is really exaggerated. As far as my experience is, we hear them, we ask questions, we see the raw material, their secret material itself. It's not the best, as I said, because they cannot see the detainees. But I want to be very careful when I'm talking about another system. I think on that we do much more than American courts, and I say it very carefully.
So do you think that's right, Justice Ginsburg?
And the closest thing is our FISA court. This is a court where presentations are ex parte. It's,
yes,
by the government. The other side doesn't get to see the materials. But It's better than nothing that there are life tenured judges who are, just as in Israel, going over the material.
Yes, of course.
To keep the government as close to honest as they can.
But we don't have a system like that for, in which the Supreme Court, for example, would look at individual detainee cases. And in fact, I don't think, when the Supreme Court ruled that there is the right of habeas corpus for Guantanamo detainees, there were a number of federal district courts that said, these people, you haven't shown a justification for holding them. But in each case, they were overruled by the Court of Appeals, and the Supreme Court has never reviewed one of those cases, has never taken any of those cases, and it's never set any standards.
I think that's an accurate description of where we are.
See, I must say, this is one of the most difficult situations that the liberal countries fighting terror have to face. It's a very, very complicated situation because of the need to refer to secret materials. And that's why I said there is no ideal solution. Yet, at least, and you cannot compare what the Supreme Court in the States does and our court, because we work differently, if I'll have the opportunity. We also work on individual cases much more, and especially in these cases, they come to us from the territories. So it's not Israeli citizens, and we look to it, you know, every case, as much as we can without having the other party but the state. Yet so we are very experienced with it.
Can I ask a question? Let me interject here to ask a question.
Please.
Which is something that I got from reading this law review piece.
Yes.
The sense I got is that there is something of a back and forth between the detention authorities, the military authorities, and the court, and that while you may, in fact, accede to their wishes most of the time, you make it pretty clear that they're going to lose if they push it and they cave some of the time. You think that's, did I read that
this,
right?
This dialogue that we have, as I said, as a first instance court, with the government people, sometimes we don't have to give the decision because they understand if the court, exactly as you say, if the court thinks that the detention takes too long time, that nothing new, no new material came, because the review is every 6 months. So if nothing changed, they will not remain, even without our decision, because they'll accept, the security people will accept the court's attitude that it's time to release the person.
So how long typically are detainees held for?
You see, I don't think we have one case like here of 10 or 12 years like Guantanamo. I think it could be 3 years, and about 3 years. Anyway, the review is all the time, and if nothing new happens, they have to release them after. Depends, of course, what is the reason that they are detained. We live in the midst of the situation. I think the comparison is not a comparison, not for good and not for bad, because when we are talking about releasing the people, we are talking about people who will be in our territories or in Israel. In Israel, very, very rare. We almost don't have detentions, administered detentions. Those are Palestinians who belong to the organization, to the Hamas or other terrorist organizations. Yet they have access directly to the Supreme Court. I think it's a lot in such a difficult situation. I am not satisfied, but I can't see any better solution in that situation.
I think it's remarkable how the Israeli Supreme Court has operated. You, Dorit, and your predecessor, Aharon Barak, something that Barak wrote in one of his judgments was, if we are so overwhelmed by our security concerns that we're willing to sacrifice human rights. We could not give our enemies a greater victory because we will become more, we will resemble our enemies more and more. So he talked about sometimes in a democracy has to fight with one hand behind its back.
This is what President Barack said in his very important decision that torture is not allowed, and this is a prohibition, an international prohibition, that you cannot change and you have to respect it. And he said this is the fate of a democracy. It fights with one hand tied behind. And it should be worthwhile to keep those values of a democracy. And this is a price that we have to pay. And this is the notion of the court all the time.
So Justice Ginsburg, when I introduce you, and I think the last time I was here, praise God, I actually kept the outline of my interview so that I was not too duplicative. I always say that you, as a result of your work as a pioneer in women's rights, you made the country into what it is today for women. That when you began, there were hundreds, maybe thousands of laws that were on the books, most of them probably enacted trying to be nice to women, but ended up penalizing women. Would you briefly outline for the audience your very first case, the one that your beloved husband Marty used to refer to as the mother brief, Moritz case?
Oh, that was a case that never went to the Supreme. Well, the government tried to take it to the Supreme Court, but we prevailed in the Tenth Circuit, and the Supreme Court denied review. But I should tell them what the Moritz case was about. Charles E. Moritz took good care of his mother, though she was 93. And he had a job. He was a bookseller. Sometimes he went on the road, and he hired a nurse to take care of his mother when he wasn't there. And there was a deduction in the Internal Revenue Code at the time for a child, I think it was under the age of 12, or an infirm relative, infirm person that you took care of in your home of any age. So Charles E. Moritz said, well, I take care of my mother, and so I'm entitled to that deduction. And he was told, sorry, this deduction is available only to a woman, not a man. And he wrote, he represented himself in the tax court and wrote a brief. It was the soul of simplicity. It said, if I were a dutiful daughter, I would get this deduction. I'm a dutiful son. That doesn't make any sense. Now, I have to tell you that one of the arguments that the government raised, and they lost big on this one, Charles E. Moritz had not proved that he was able to take care of his mother himself. He had not proved that the nurse was a substitute for himself because he couldn't do the job. And just think about that, the idea that women, of course, can take care of elderly parents, but men cannot. Now, one of the reasons why the government lost big on that one is when the case was presented to the Court of Appeals, the government had drawn up this stipulation. And Charles E. Moritz, who certainly was not a lawyer, accepted the government's stipulation. If that had been an issue, he would have been able to prove how his life was, his whole life was, I shouldn't say ruined, but what he could do was very limited. I mean, this mother, there was a time when she was in a nursing home and she ran away. So he had taken great care of his mother, and that, but that the government would make such an argument, I thought was
the government. The government appealed to the Supreme Court because you won in the Tenth Circuit, and it did something fairly extraordinary when it appended a list.
Yeah. And this is now, this is back, Morris was what, 1972? Long before PCs were in everybody's home and office. So the government, when they asked the court to review this case, they said, we know that Congress has changed the law prospectively, so dutiful sons in the future will not encounter this problem. But the Tenth Circuit's decision casts a cloud over dozens of federal statutes. And then they had a printout from the Department of Defense, mainframe computer, of every provision in the United States Code that differentiated on the basis of sex. Now, I mean, that was a greater gift we couldn't have. We knew what they all were. And so many of them were really cosmetic, and Congress passed a bill that changed many, and the ones that they didn't change, we litigated.
It was the roadmap. It was the Ginsburg roadmap. There's been a great deal of discussion over the years that I'm not going to go back and forth to. Except that there was a case, another case of yours that didn't get to the Supreme Court, and it was an abortion case.
Yeah, it was a choice.
It was a non-abortion.
It was a choice case.
Yes,
it was a choice case.
Okay.
And it really was a choice.
Yeah.
In Susan Strzok's case, her choice was to bear her child. Susan Strzok was a captain in the Air Force, and she was serving in Vietnam. And while there, she became pregnant. So she said that she would take just all of her accumulated leave, and the base commander said, Captain Strzok, you have two choices. Either you get an abortion, which we will give you on base, or you're out of the service. You're automatically discharged. Now, Susan was Catholic, and it was against her religious scruples to have an abortion. So she was given a discharge notice. She had good ACLU lawyers in the state of Washington when she was sent back to the West Coast. Month by month, they got her discharge stayed, so she was always in, seeking to stay in. And her argument was, government has no business telling me whether I can or can't bear a child. They can't say the cost of your bearing this child is your work. So this was a case where the government was offering her only one choice, have an abortion or you lose your job. If the court had gotten that as the first case, oh, by the way, why didn't it? Why didn't the court get the case? Susan lost in the district court. She lost 2-1 in the Court of Appeals with an excellent dissent. And, and then we petitioned for review. At that time, Erwin Wiesrold, who was for many, many years the dean of the Harvard Law School, was our Solicitor General. And he saw great damage potential for the government in Susan's case. So he met with the top military people and said, this rule is not something that you should have. You should immediately waive Captain Strzok's discharge, keep her in the service, and then change the regulation prospectively, so that other women will not encounter the problem that she did. And so Susan was told, we'll keep you in. And immediately, the Solicitor General then filed a motion asking the court to return the case to the Court of Appeals because it had become moot. Susan got all the relief that she wanted, which was to stay in service. I called her and said, is there anything you're missing that we can urge keeps your case alive? And she said, well, I'm not out any pay. I've got all my pay and allowances. So I don't think there's anything you could do. But then she said, well, maybe this. She said, my dream is to become a pilot, but the Air Force doesn't give flight training to women. And then the two of us in 1972, we knew that was an impossible dream. We could not win that case at that time. And now, I mean, there is some real progress. It would be unthinkable for the service to say, we won't give women flight training.
Is this what you mean by a living constitution?
This was also an Israeli decision in the court. Women didn't serve as pilots until it came to the Supreme Court. And this was a court decision that they should. Again, we go step by step with all these issues and things that are today unthinkable were accepted 30 years ago, even 20 years ago.
So if you cast your mind back to 1972, and someone had said to you that year, what do you think about bringing a case for gay marriage? What would you have thought back then? If you can push your brain back that far, well, that long ago.
That long ago, I don't think such a case would have a chance to succeed. And this is the reason. The cases in the 1970s, I mean, I was there at the right time, but the times had changed. Women were complaining about the inequality. Women were urging that they have a right to control their own destiny. Young women, my daughter was in high school, and I remember her and her classmates were really into this thing. They wanted the Equal Rights Amendment passed, and the times were changing. I mean, I could even see it. My children are 10 years apart. When my daughter started school, she's the older one, I was one of very few working mothers. 10 years later, when my son started school, it wasn't at all unusual to have a two-earner family. So the way people were living had changed. And I think what happened in the gay rights movement is that people who hid what they were came public and they said, this is who I am. And other people looked around and said, oh, that's my next door neighbor that I'm very fond of. Or that's my child's best friend. Or maybe it's my child. It's that people willing to come forward and say, this is what I am, and it is okay. That, I think, you had to have that change in society. You had to have the change in the way people regarded things. I think a lot of people woke up when they saw that all these people that I know and like are gay. So I think that explains why in the 70s the women's rights cases were successful, because the court was really catching up to a change that had already occurred in the larger society. I think it's the same way now with same-sex marriage, that the court is catching up to the way people are living.
President Beinisch, Your Supreme Court hears thousands of cases each year. Whereas our Supreme Court hears fewer than 100, they hit more like 80. Our court can pick and choose which cases it can hear. Yours doesn't necessarily do that. You sit in panels of 3, 4, 5, even 9 people of the 15 justices. And you have this enormous brief of what you can are asked to rule on and do rule on. And as an example, the case that I was really quite fascinated with was one of your opinions I don't remember if it was unanimous or 8-1, but it was about private prisons. Can you talk about that?
Yes, first, just a few words. It's really the difference that, because we are also a court of appeal, not only for historical reasons, our Supreme Court is not only a court that reviews, like yours, a constitutional issues, but it's also a court of appeal. There, when it's an appeal by right, we have no discretion if to take the case or not. This is true. On certiorari's, on judicial review, administrative or constitutional, we can choose. But it is true that everything comes to Supreme Court in Israel, really everything. And it's a very influential court. So as to the private prisons, this was legislation. This was under a constitutional case because we thought that as justices, as I said before, today, since 1992, the court may review the legislature. And a private prison was never, unlike in the United States, we never had private prison. And it was a serious question for us, a constitutional question, if you can put prisoners under the control of a private contractor who has a profit interest in this, in running the prison, and has it's kind of a business. And this was for us, I mean, very, very controversial in the country. And this is true that I wrote the decision that to keep a person under using power in prison is only the right of the state and not a right of any private person, a private entity. And so we interfered with that legislation and declared it not constitutional.
At that point, were there private prisons or the government?
They just built the first one. The first one is a private enterprise. The government claimed that this will be cheaper, it will not be a burden on our economy. Even this wasn't really proved when I saw the data. I wasn't sure about it. But we thought that this is our way of dignity of a person, that the dignity of a person and the liberty of a person shouldn't be in the hands of a private entity. So this was really a revolutionary decision, but just in time, because the prison wasn't yet inaugurated, it wasn't open, it just they started to build it, and we stopped it.
It's one thing that's different. The Supreme Court is the highest court on matters of federal law, and could be a statute passed by Congress, an action by an executive officer, a constitutional question. But the everyday law in the United States is handled by state courts.
Yes.
And so Israel is a unitary state.
Of course.
And there's no separate, there are no state courts.
Of course, federal and states we don't have. Yes. We're a small country. We have one system, thank God for that, because this is complicated enough.
So
we are a very complex society, although it's a unitary system, this is true. So to deal with it is enough for our court.
And something else that You have very relaxed notions of who has standing to sue,
yes,
who has standing to complain.
Well, I didn't really relate to our differences, but this is true that, and this gives the court the power to review, coming back to detainees and other security matters and others. We don't demand the right of standing. I mean, NGOs can come to the court, people who think that this is a matter of a claim, that this is a matter of the rule of law, we would listen to them. We are not strict, as you said, Ruth, with the rules of standing. And this is really one of the things that gives the court the power to review things, that because sometimes, you know, either there is no one who will complain, and this is a matter that the public of public interest, rights of minorities, rights of groups, of immigrants, people from the territories, not always a person can come by himself to the court. So if someone claims, and we see that this is a real, of course we have discretion with that. As you said, we are very lenient on that.
So how are the Supreme Court justices appointed?
Yes. Well, it's a very different system. I can tell you that our politicians envy the Americans for the system of appointing judges, because we claim that our system is apolitical. We have a committee headed by the Minister of Justice, which is of course a member of the executive and is a political figure, another member of the government, two ministers. It's nine people, it consists of nine people. So two ministers headed, as I said, by the Minister of Justice. The three Supreme Court justices with the President of the Court, ex officio, and two other justices, those are three. Two members of the Knesset, our parliament, legislature, and two members of the bar. So those are the nine. And I think it's, you know, there is no perfect system of appointing judges also. There are advantages and disadvantages. But here it's kind of a balance between the political part of branches and the judicial branch. And it worked, not bad.
There has been some effort, some push from the right to change that system. And I think I'm right in saying that Mr. Netanyahu has opposed changing the system.
Yes.
Is it a serious push to change the system?
From time to time, we hear voices. Yes, of members of parliament. I don't think it's serious. I think our tradition, I hope, of the system is very strong. It's very strong. Like every system has its, you know, it's built in the society. I hope they will not. So sometimes they say, why won't we take the American system and we'll have a political nominations and hearings? You can't take one stone from the building and put it in another system. It doesn't work. It's part of our tradition. It's part of our culture that everyone is involved, every branch. Yet Israel, because of many reasons that many people know, is very much politically oriented as a state. If the decisions of appointing a judge would be a political decision, I am worried about the independence of the court. Because I think the most important thing for a democracy, and you mentioned it before, is an independent court. This is the guarantee for our values, democratic values, and our rule of law. So if politicians will be too much involved, they have a say, of course, because it has to do with different problems of our society. That's why I say that our combination of political and judicial figures in this process of appointing is not a bad one, I think so.
What was the model for it?
It started since, you know, it's interesting because it's our own legislation. It was our own legislation. The British took after us, which was because many of our system, many things came from the British. Of course, this was before the state was established. They ruled the territory. So with them, it was political appointments by the chancellor, of course, and the political. With us, this was a decision, a very important decision, when the state was founded. And we have a special law for that. And this is one of our basic laws. So I don't, it's not only Mr. Netanyahu. I don't think that any prime minister elected in Israel would dare to change the system, although he has some people thinking. Those are always people who want the court to be weaker, not so strong. They think it's we are too strong. I don't think so, but that's the way they think. So, but I hope this will not change. And this is really interesting because the British, when they changed it, not the chancellor anymore, it was the Blair government, they also have a committee, but a bigger one with more people involved from the public, which is also, sometimes it comes up in our system, the idea.
Justice Ginsburg, your voice is now the voice of dissent in so many big Supreme Court cases. Last term, it was the Hobby Lobby contraception case, which I'll give you 30 seconds to tell us what the core of your dissent, because it's... they're gonna...
But those who don't know, Hobby Lobby, the owners were... it was a tenet of their faith that abortions are sinful. And so when the healthcare legislation passed and required that contraceptive services be available as part of the package, these owners said, well, it's against our religion, so we won't provide that coverage. What I said in my dissenting opinion is we have the right to think, speak, believe as we will. And the government can't tell us that we're wrong thinking or wrong believing. But what we cannot do is to swing our arms so it hits people who do not share our religious belief. Now, if Hobby Lobby was a community of believers, this wouldn't be an issue because the employees would not want to use contraceptive services. But they are in business for profit. They're employing hundreds, thousands of women who don't share their belief. And that's where my freedom of religion has to stop, when I cannot project it onto people who are not part of my religious community.
So, my fellow journalists and me also have written increasingly about the strength of your dissenting voice, not just in Hobby Lobby, but in voting rights cases, in campaign finance cases, in all manner of cases. Yours has become sort of the clarion voice of dissent. So what has changed between your voice now and what it was just a few years ago? What is the qualitative difference?
The retirement of Justice John Paul Stevens. You know, everything that the court does goes by seniority. So when the chief is in the majority, he assigns the opinion. When he's not, the most senior justice does. And when we divide 5-4, then the most senior justice of the four will assign the dissent. So this was new business for me after John Paul Stevens left. And I had him as a model, and I think, Nina, it's fair to say that he had more than his fair share of the dissents that were 5-4. So I tried to spread it evenly among my colleagues, but I think everybody agreed that certain dissents I should write, and that was true, certainly true of Hobby Lobby. But so I am more often in the fore since Justice O'Connor left. I mean, that made a big difference in the composition of the court. Because every case, you could trace the year that she left us, where I was in the four, I most likely would have been in the five if she had remained on the court.
When you joined the court, Justice O'Connor was there, so you served with her for many years and you were great colleagues and friends. When she retired and was replaced by Justice Alito, you were the only woman for 3 years. And you didn't like that at all, as I recall.
It was very lonely. And
it's not funny, I understand it very well.
it gave the public a wrong view of the US system of justice. I mean, here, at least when Sandra was there, she's a tall woman. When she left, there was just this little woman. And so the picture was altogether wrong. Well, now compare how it is. Because of my seniority, I sit toward the middle. And on my left is Justice Kagan. On my right, Justice Sotomayor. When the public comes to watch the court these days, they see that we're one-third of the bench, but probably among the more active participants in oral argument. I mean, my two new colleagues are not shrinking violets. They're always very well prepared for argument, and they're not reluctant to ask questions. So the public sees that there are women on this court. They are very lively taking part in the colloquy.
I could imagine, though, that there are some of your male colleagues who would hear you say, and probably have read you say before, that you were lonely in those 3 years. And they would say to themselves, why is that? I mean, we're perfectly good colleagues. What's her beef?
Yeah, well, no one wants to be a one-at-a-time curiosity, and that's what I was. I mean, I was the only one. It wasn't the way the court should be at this time in our history. So people ask me sometimes, when do you think there will be enough? And my answer is, when there are nine. And when that answer is greeted with astonishment, I said, but for most of the country's history, there were nine and they were all men, and nobody thought that was
weird.
Strange.
I want, on a somewhat lighter note, I want to ask you about the notorious RBG t-shirts. I gather there are some people here who worn them. I wear mine on the weekends all the time. And people will occasionally, the guy at the drugstore said to me last weekend, he said, who is that woman? She looks very familiar, but who is she? I said, she's a Supreme Court justice. He said, oh good, I've learned something today. So how did you find out about the notorious RBG t-shirts?
I think a law clerk told me about this tumbler. And also explained to me what notorious RBG was, a parody on. And now my grandchildren love it. and I try to keep abreast of the latest that's on the Tumblr. I also have, and in fact, I think I gave you your RBG.
Yes, you gave me two of my three.
Yeah.
I bought one.
I have quite a large supply.
Do you have the, what's the one about the You can't have truth without Ruth.
Without Ruth, yeah.
Let me ask you both this question. Women judges and journalists like to think that they do the same job that men do, and they do. And they like to think that they do it as well, and they do. But aren't there some issues that arise? You know, I'm as much like you are in the sense that people say, well, what's the difference between a woman reporter and a male reporter? What's the difference between a woman judge and a male judge? I'm not going to ask you that stupid question. But what I am going to ask you is, aren't there some issues, and that I'm asking both of you this question, that arise in which men are in fact pretty oblivious and women are not?
Well, you've already mentioned one classic example, and that's Lily Ledbetter's case. Now, in her case, there wasn't any question that she was doing the same work. But what the court said, after she won in the trial court, our court said, Lily Ledbetter sued too late. The law, Title VII, says you have to file a complaint with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission 180 days after the discriminatory incident. And Lily Ledbetter has been working here, oh, nearly 20 years, and so she woke up one day and sued. She was much too late. Now, what I think some of my colleagues did not understand is, let's say that Lily Ledbetter knew that she was being paid less. She didn't know because the Goodyear Tire Company didn't give out the pay figures. But let's say she did know. She brings a case. The defense will certainly be, it has nothing to do with Lily being a woman. She just doesn't do the job as well as the men. Now, year after year, she gets good performance ratings. That defense is no longer available. The employer itself has said Lily Ledbetter is a competent worker. So when she has a winnable case,
it's too late.
Too late. Now, I think every woman, at least in every woman of my age, knows that if you're the first woman in a field that has been occupied mainly by men, you don't want to be seen as a troublemaker. You don't want to rock the boat. So Lily's idea and mine, it was very simple. She gets paid month by month. Every month, the discrimination is renewed. So she has 180 days from the most recent paycheck. And then I ended the opinion by saying, the ball is now in Congress's court to fix the error into which my colleagues have fallen. And in record time, Congress did pass the law that adopted the paycheck rule. So, that, another case. Were you at the argument of the 13-year-old
who was strip searched? Yeah. Mm.
So this 13-year-old girl is suspected of carrying drugs in her purse.
A Tylenol.
Advil. So she was...
Prescription strength.
She was called to the girl's room and strip searched. Her mother was furious. And so her mother brought a civil rights suit under 1983 to say, this school district has done something that deeply wounded my daughter. And I want them to stop doing that. And I want my daughter to be compensated for the humiliation that she suffered. Well, at the oral argument, it began to be like fun and games. And one of my colleagues said, well, I remember being 13-year-old and we used to undress in the locker room and nobody thought anything about that. So I had great success in doing this, in explaining that a 13-year-old girl is at a very sensitive stage of her life. And she isn't like a 13-year-old boy in the locker room. And I think when I said that from the bench, it stopped.
Well, in all fairness, I have to say that if you could have been there, you would have seen this smoke coming out of the Ginsburg ears. It wasn't really subtle. I mean, she just sat up. So let me put this question to you.
It's the same thing. It's really, I think we are more sensitive to certain issues because it's an experience you bring with you to your office. You bring your education, your experience, your personality, and being a woman is one of that qualities. When you're a woman, it's different. In our case, the Lily Ledbetter, very similar case, it was even worse with the time because she got a decision from the labor court and she didn't go to the court. She needed a group, the women's group, to bring it to the court. It took 3 years after she lost the case. And so it's latches. We usually, after 3 years, we don't hear the case. But I insisted and we decided, the same as you decided. I mean, there are things, all the sexual harassment cases, most of them I did. Because, you know, as you say, well, it's an office, this is the way they do things, nothing. It takes time to understand. And those are changes in society too. I think it takes time to people to understand. And when we went into the court for the first time, a panel of three women, you saw the lawyers, you know, smiling a bit, not taking it seriously. Three women come, it won't happen today anymore. It takes time. And for years I thought that maybe there is no difference. We are trying to be so objective, this is true. We want all to be very objective. So people will feel that everyone, doesn't matter in front of who is the judge that you argue. But there is, we have to admit, with other things that we bring with us, we bring a certain sensitivity, I think, that not always understood by men.
No, there's a very good illustration of that. One of Justice O'Connor's decisions, her very first year on the court, the case was Mississippi University for Women, Hogan v. Mississippi University for Women. So Hogan was a man who wanted to study nursing. And the best school, he thought, was Mississippi University for Women. They had the best training in the area where he lived. But he was denied admission. Now, some of the justices on the Supreme Court thought, well, that's kind of an affirmative action for women. I mean, isn't it? They exclude men, they prefer women. Sandra, being a woman, understood that the best thing you could do for women in a field that is dominated by women is to get men to do the job. And so you could see, on one hand, thinking, this is a favor for women. And Sandra said, oh, no, it isn't. And you could read between the lines that she had that understanding and was able to persuade a majority of the court.
So before I turn to the questions from the audience, I just want to observe that you both were married with children when you were young, up-and-coming lawyers. And President Beinisch, I'm wondering how you managed your childcare in those days when you were a young lawyer, when you were in the state's attorney's office.
I don't know how I did it.
Mm.
It's, first of all, it's not easy. And when you look backward, you think, all this happened to me. It wasn't really, it was a tough time. But I think I had, you know, everyone has his recipe. I thought that the fact that the family is involved, that my girls, since they were very little, knew what I'm doing. We were discussing things, bringing them into it, and they were proud, they were happy. I mean, you need all those technical arrangements. And I remember the state attorney for the state sitting in a meeting, you know, with, it was security matters, could sit in the room, 20 people from the military officers, and I had to say sometimes, excuse me for 15 minutes, and I ran to bring my daughter from the kindergarten to home and come back. It happened. You can't do it in the court, but when I am the attorney, I tried. But normally, I was working until late at night. They don't remember that I had my way to compensate. It's not easy, but I think the way your attitude, how it is important to participate in this process, to know what's happening, and you give the solutions to the family in another way. But I at the end, I found out that I know what's happening in school better than any other mother, that I know more. I knew the friends, I knew everybody. They came home, they said that I'm asking them about the books they read and they don't like it. But at the end, to be involved with and to make them be involved in my, this was the way I do it, and this, I did it, and this is the way I'm always telling my young people who work with me, my all the people, the assistants, it's possible. It's not easy, but it's possible. So you can do that and enjoy it. So
Justice Ginsburg, you, I know that you hid your second pregnancy, having lost a job over your first pregnancy. And when you were in law school, you already had a two-year-old daughter, and you had a husband who was sick at the time. Marty was sick, very sick. How did you do it from that point on?
I can tell about my wonderful father-in-law. When I became pregnant, and it was in the 2 years that Marty was serving in Fort Sill, Oklahoma, and I was really worried about how was I going to manage Harvard Law School with a child? And my father-in-law said, Ruth, if you don't want to go to law school, you have the best reason in the world. Nobody will think the less of you. But if you really want to be a lawyer, you will stop feeling sorry for yourself and you will find a way. And I have thought at every turn, do I really want this? And if I do, I will find a way. Now, of course, I had a wonderful partner in life who was an extraordinary man. I mean, Marty, I'd say that he was an equal parent to our children. He was the first boy I ever knew who cared that I had a brain. and that, I think, he was so secure in what he was, that he never regarded me as any kind of threat. On the contrary, when I get to Harvard Law School and I'm really intimidated the first year, and Marty is saying, oh, my wife, she's going to be on the law review. there was a woman in the class ahead of mine, she said, this husband of yours is boasting that you're going to be on the law review. You look like a little twerp. So, but he was my biggest booster. And that was an enormous help. Now, I will say that when my son was young, I think you know this story very well, Nina. So, he was a lively child. I called him lively. His teachers called him hyperactive. And I would get called to see the headmaster or the room teacher or the school psychologist about once a month. And then one day I said, this child has two parents. Please alternate calls. And it's his, it's his father's turn. So Marty went to the school, and there he faced the headmaster and the room teacher and the psychologist. Your son stole the elevator. So Marty's response was, how far could he take it? Well, after that, the calls came barely once a semester because people thought long and hard about taking a man away from his work and didn't give a thought at all about disturbing a woman who had work to do.
Well, we have a lot of questions.
Excuse me. Mm-hmm. I think that after we were talking about how important it is to be an independent woman, stronger woman, to see the rights of women, and it is important, and I think we both share those views, it makes it easier when you have a husband that supports, I must say. This is important. And. I know it from my colleagues too. It and of course for myself. This is important.
You know, when Justice O'Connor was called by President Reagan, and he told her that he was going to nominate her to the Supreme Court, her husband John O'Connor went out and bought a diary that he was going to keep because he knew that she was going to be very burdened with work, but he thought that there ought to be a record. But that's John O'Connor also initiated Marty into the Dennis Thatcher Club. And do you know what that is? It's only one qualification.
My husband's a member of the Dennis Thatcher Society.
It's that your wife has a job that in your heart of hearts you would really like to have.
My husband says it's a job that makes her at least publicly more important than you are. Well, we have a lot of questions here. This one, I think this one, Chief Justice Beinisch, was for you. The Israeli documentary, The Law in These Parts, puts forward the hypothesis that judicial oversight over the occupation made it more palatable to the Israeli public, perhaps entrenching it. What is the proper judicial oversight with respect to the occupation, and would you reconsider any decisions with hindsight, with the hindsight of knowing how long it's lasted?
I'm not sure I understand the question, because there is the political issue, there is which the court is not involved in. I think we do have, and I gave only very one example when we talked about the fence, there is an oversight by the court on things that are happening in the territories. And some say that with this we legitimate the occupation, which is of course not true. We do not decide the political aspect, and we should not. But when we have a situation of occupation, I think this is the role of the court to see to it. And I was talking about it before. This oversight is needed because, and the fact that it takes such a long time, one of the things is that the court took the international law and tried to adopt it to the situation of what we call prolonged occupation, which needs more care about rights of the people in the territories. Of course, the political solution will come, but it's not in the hands of the court. But the oversight is very important. I dread to think what would happen if we would leave all this to the hands of the army, the military, even in good faith. They have power, they need it to keep the territories. We need this oversight on what's happening.
This is a question for both of you. What can you discuss what in your backgrounds set the stage for the path that you have taken in civil rights and justice? Don't all jump in at once.
A powerful influence for me was at the time I was in college, 1950 to 54. It was a bad time for the country. It was the heyday of Senator Joe McCarthy. Mm-hmm. And people were being called before the House Un-American Activities Committee and the Senate Internal Security Committee. I had the good luck to be a research assistant for a great professor of constitutional law at the undergraduate level, Professor Cushman. And he wanted me to appreciate that our country was straying from its most basic values, the right to think and speak and write as one believes and not as Big Brother government tells us we should mm-hmm. think. And that there were lawyers standing up for these people and reminding our Congress that we have a First Amendment protecting the freedom of expression, and that we have a Fifth Amendment, which allows people to refuse to incriminate themselves. So then it dawned on me that, well, law is something I probably would like to do. There was a question, well, so you would like to do it, who's going to hire you?
Yeah.
But I will say that when I got married, which was the same month that I graduated from college, that worry was people who cared about me said, okay, you can do what you want, because if you don't get a job and you can't make it, you'll have a man to support you.
Justice Beinisch, what do you think it is in your background that put you on this path?
First of all, it's not easy. It's the whole complex. First of all, as Ruth said, the background comes always in the time where you get your basic education, where you see the reality, what happens in your country. And if you have those senses, you want to react. This was my education also, in a way, even before the legal education at home. The country was poor, problems were so many. Immigrants coming from all over, survivors from Holocaust. The house, my home was very sensitive to this, my parents were sensitive to the, what can you contribute to society? And what brought me actually to what I did later was that you have the feeling that you have to do something to change or to contribute to your society. And this was since those early years. And I think it's part of you when you grow up like that and when you see what's happening around you. And as you said, I think if you mentioned the 50s with the McCarthy, it's people who are sensitive to that, who get the right education, cannot see it and just keep quiet. So there were many fights later that I had to do before I was in court, and not to accept everything that's happening, and on the other hand, to contribute to your society where you live.
Justice Ginsburg, one of our audience asks, how difficult is it to separate, and I would imagine this would be a perfectly good question for you too, how difficult is it for you to separate your raw feelings from the ability to be a good judge?
How difficult is it? Well, we both serve on collegial courts. And nobody put me there to be queen. if I tried to be queen, you can imagine how the other eight would respond. But I think it's our realization that we have to work as a collegial body. And by the way, we talked a lot about 5-4 decisions. Our unanimity rate is much higher than our 5-4 dissents. So I guess in part is if you are not willing to work in a collegial way, you shouldn't be in an appellate court.
I agree. This is a you know, not only that, you have to come to kind of understanding and agreements. If your court, this is the precedent that binds other courts, you want to come, sometimes you have to separate and to come to a kind of understanding between you and to respect the collegial work with others. This is part of you. You're not alone in the court. And you get used to separate your own feelings from the way you do. You have to, and just to what you believe is true, your ideas, for this you stand. All the other you give,
it's... So let me ask you both this question. Have your colleagues ever changed your mind? And I don't mean on some nitpicky little stupid case. I mean on something that you thought, well, maybe I need to rethink this?
Please,
I think
us.
That we are engaged in the art of persuasion all the time. Yeah. I'm trying to persuade my colleagues to get to that magic number 5.
But with all deference, that's not what I asked you. I asked you. I asked you whether anybody had ever persuaded you.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. And
I'd ask you which case, but you probably wouldn't tell me.
No. The exercise is so you're preparing all along, and then you're all together on the bench thinking about the issue at the same time. And then there's the conference, which comes very soon after the oral argument, and you hear what your colleagues have to say. I will admit that most times I go out of the conference the same way I came in, but not always. It's important to be a good listener and not to be so attached to your own view that you close your mind to another way.
President Beinisch, what is the current role of the Israeli Supreme Court in protecting the individual rights of Arab Israelis?
Most important, Arab Israelis are Israeli citizens. They have their rights, not always, like we said, it's not only the Arab Israelis, not always accepted by everybody when they apply it. And that's what the court stands for, of course. And I think that we, and many, many things, many issues, we interfered to protect this equality that is needed in rights, in education, housing, not always accepted by everyone, but of course in getting jobs in the government and all these kind of things. Everything comes to the court, and they have a very strong human rights association, and if they complain on discrimination, they come to the court. And I think the court has did a lot. I must say, my belief is the court can advance, set the norms, go ahead, but it's not enough, the court. I mean, you need the people to understand the social process to go. As we were discussing with women's rights, it's not enough. It's basic that the court will set the right norms and stand for equality. But in order to apply it in society and to be against extremes who are discriminating against Arabs, everyone should cooperate, not only the court. It starts from the court, it doesn't end in the court.
Did you have an Arab Israeli on
yes.
the court?
Yes, of course. Yes.
And I know Abdallah is very
That's
active.
What I mentioned when I said that we have a group, it's Abdallah. And Abdallah does a lot and brings many problems to the court. And I think the court was very, very important and influential in the matters that Abdallah brings as to the rights of the...
Do you know Hassan Jabarin?
Of course.
So
he argued many cases in our court. He's very good.
Abdallah is kind of like the NAACP Legal Defense Fund.
Yes.
For Arab Israelis. And you know that Hassan is a very exuberant person. He came to the United States to American University,
yes.
and he took a yes. human rights course, and he met Rena Rosenberg from Queens,
yeah.
and they married.
Yes. He has a Jewish wife, yes.
yes.
He was...
And I performed the ceremony.
Ah, yes, this I didn't know. Well, this detail I didn't know. Hassan, and he has now others who work with him in Abdallah. And I think they're doing a very important job. And the court is very much involved, and we have many cases. And I think it's an important thing to... But as I said, I hope things will also work not only after the court decision, but society will recognize the importance of the rights of the Arabs, which is more difficult.
So in the name of full disclosure, Justice Ginsburg married me and my husband also. Only we married late in life because we were both widowed, and he was utterly convinced, or at least worried about the fact that this might not be legal. So that when she pronounced us husband and wife, she said, in the name of the Constitution of the United States and the Congress of the United States, I pronounce you husband and wife.
When the day comes and we will have civil marriages, maybe judges can do that.
But I stopped saying Congress, because somebody said, that's, the judiciary is an independent branch. So I say now, by the authority vested in me by the Constitution and laws of the United States.
So there's a question here for you, Justice Ginsburg, which sort of hems and haws around the, but I think basically the question is, how come you are such good friends with that guy Scalia?
Because he makes me laugh. We were buddies on the DC circuit, and before that, when we were both in the law teaching business, I attended a talk that he was giving. I disagreed with almost everything that he said, but I was charmed by the way he said it. And we have some things that we share. Both of us care very much about family. And we both love music, and particularly opera, which is the reason why there is this opera, Scalia Ginsburg, that will, I hope, have its first fully staged performance next summer.
There's a duet in it that's your favorite?
Well, the duet is... Now, first I should start with Scalia's Rage aria because it's so good. The justices are blind. How can they possibly spout this? The Constitution says absolutely nothing about this. And then my answering aria is, you are searching for bright line solutions to problems that don't have easy answers, but the great thing about our Constitution is, like our society, it can evolve. And then the scene that I like best is Justice Scalia is locked in a dark room he's being punished for excessive dissenting. And I come to rescue him. Now, I enter that scene through a glass ceiling. But the last duet you asked about, Nina, it is, we are different, we are one. It is different in the way we go about interpreting the Constitution, one in our reverence for the federal judiciary and the institution we serve.
So I probably ought to ask you another question, but that seems too good a way to end. And it's about time. So.